A very good morning to all of you. So my name is Shruti Shah. I think ab utna familiarity ho gayi hai because we've been conducting frequent sessions. So I welcome you all on this session of discussion, basically on the questions of ethics, as in GS Paper 4, Mains 2020. I know this is one of the most awaited session because there were a lot of students who were asking us how to go about the questions or how to approach the questions of ethics paper, or for that matter case studies, to be very specific. Okay? So before we start, going by the norms of ethics, effort is important, but knowing where to make the effort makes all the difference. I know, most of us, time and again, we talk about more than hard work, it is the smart work which is required. Your direction in which you have to channelize your preparation is very much important. But then, you need to keep on retelling yourself about these things, because then it gets registered in your subconscious mind that before putting an effort, you should make a conscious effort that in what direction those efforts needs to be put in. Is that very clear? Irrespective of how much hard work you are putting in, if you are not aware about the direction in which the hard work needs to be invested, the output would not be according to your intended desires. Is that very clear for everyone? Right? So on this note, we are going to structure today's session. Now, how we are going to go about it is, we are together, three of us. There are three faculties, me, Jatin sir and Aditya sir. We would be conducting today's session according to our areas of expertise. I would be discussing six questions which have come in section A, and then the respective faculties would be taking up other questions as well as the case studies. Is that very clear? Theek hai? Now, before we start, see, I don't know, this is a basic observation, and I've been telling this time and again in other sessions as well, that there are three areas which are very much neglected by most of us. I know, you must be wondering, why am I saying three areas? Because essay and ethics is something which we know, right? Optional also. It is one of the neglected section. Why am I saying this? A lot of people who have been joining us or who have been our students, they always come us and tell that, ma'am, GS ke liye we have done the coaching, but do you think for optional we require any guidance? I said, do you have a background? And they said, no, we are to engineers or for that matter doctors or some other field. Maine kaha, for GS you are joining the coaching, and for optional you think you don't require a coaching, right? Or coaching, exactly, coaching does not mean joining some, but yes, definitely mentorship or guidance is required. Similarly, there are two sessions which are neglected as far as GS is also concerned. One is essay and other is ethics. And we don't even realize that how much marks you are putting at stake. Right? 250 marks of essay and 250 marks of ethics. They are very much important. And I know that most of you are aware of the fact that the highest score this year in ethics paper has been 162. It's not even funny. Out of 250, you've been scoring 162. Apart from essay, there is no other paper which gives you this much of scope, because in essay also 172 has been the highest, or 175 also one time the student has secured. So it is only essay and ethics, if you put in your efforts dedicatedly, knowing what is the expectation of UPSC, the output can be very rewarding. So if I go by input-output ratio or the cost-benefit analysis for that matter, this is highly rewarding section. But you know what is the problem? Problem is our attitude. I don't know whether I have discussed this before or not, but the problem is our attitude. The attitude problem lies, we all prepare to clear prelims. we don't prepare with the attitude to clear this entire exam. And we don't even realize, with all due respect, ये CA का exam नहीं है कि एक stage clear हो गई, then you have to worry about other stages only. Here, at any given point of time, if you falter, you have to repeat the entire cycle. And clearing prelims is also no joke. Today you have cleared prelims. If you do not capitalize on it and make sure that you clear the last stage, that is mains as well as interview, then it is no guarantee that the next time you will be clearing prelims for sure. Are you getting the point? And there are most of us who just end up clearing prelims only every year because the efforts have not been made to clear mains or for that matter the entire examination. So you focus only on those subjects which are very specific to prelims preparation, because this is a very common attitude. And why am I able to say this? Why am I holding resonance with this fact? Because I have been the sufferer from this attitude. कि एक बार प्री तो हो जाए उसके बाद मेंस वाली बात आएगी. Are you getting the point? And that was the result my first attempt suffered, because I was only focusing on prelims and I managed to clear it, but then I was not prepared for mains. Are you getting the point? And then most of us also wait for the result of prelims to make sure that chalo, now we can start with the preparation of mains. That is not how you should go about this preparation. Is that very clear? And we've been telling this time and again, there is no watertight compartmentalized preparation. It has to be a collaborative, integrative approach. Now this year you have your prelims in June, that also last week of June. So it is very much advisable, at least till mains, put in efforts to prepare those areas which are specifically asked in mains. And how can you neglect essay and ethics? Everything else can take a backseat. Your security, your world history, everything can take a backseat. Post-independence though, absolutely can take a backseat. But what cannot be neglected is essay as well as ethics paper. Is that very clear for everyone? And see, every paper has its own set of vocabulary. Every paper has its own set of expectation. So just by knowing certain elements, you cannot be prepared for ethics. You have to specifically understand that how the answers have to be written as far as ethics paper is concerned. Is that very clear for everyone? Okay. Chalo. So on this note, please, it's a heartfelt request, start taking these two papers very seriously. Yes, optional without any doubt, but essay and ethics. Or essay ke liye to I know a lot of us, and with respect to ethics also, we don't even bother about writing, right? So all of that needs to be focused upon. And please do not say ki ma'am time nahi hai, prelims se agar prelims hua nahi to kya hoga, ho bhi gaya to kya hoga. What if you clear also, tab bhi kya hoga? If you're not prepared for your mains, so what is the point of clearing prelims? Koi PT master thodi na banna hai ki har time prelims aaye clear karke chale gaye. Nahi na. So there has to be, you have to put in dedicated effort. And I know that all of you out there are sincere about clearing this exam. So that sincerity should also be reflected in your strategies. Sincerity should also be reflected in how you are approaching the paper. Just by studying does not reflect your sincerity. Is that very clear for everyone? Theek hai, chalo. On this note, let's start the session. See, as far as ethics paper is concerned, there are four things which needs to be kept in mind. First and foremost, this I say in other session also, but yes, it is very important. You have to be clear and thorough with the syllabus. And the best part about ethics syllabus is, not only they have given you the broad topics, within those broad topics, they have specifically pinpointed what they are expecting. Is that very clear? For example, they are clearly saying, they are talking about determinants of ethics, dimensions of ethics, essence of ethics, consequences of ethics. So when they give you the heading ethics and human interface, they clearly specify the subtopics also that they are expecting. Is that very clear? Similarly, when they talk about attitude, so the structure of attitude, components of attitude, functions of attitude, moral attitude, political attitude, they clearly have specified. So that is the difference between if you look at the syllabus for society and if you look at the syllabus for ethics. Obviously, I am drawing the analogy with society because that is the section which I deal with. So in society, they have given you broad headings of the syllabus, but they have not specified the subtopics which have to be prepared in the syllabus. But the best part about the ethics syllabus is not only they have given you the broad headings, but within those broad headings they have also clearly specified the subtopics that needs to be prepared. So you have to be very, very thorough with your syllabus. Every topic in the syllabus has to be covered. Again, I'll reiterate the same thing. At least my observation says UPSC does not ask very random questions. The questions are linked with the demand of the syllabus. It is sometimes that we tend to overlook the syllabus, or sometimes we don't even bother about what is the syllabus. And the problem lies especially with those students who are dependent on others. See, we are definitely there to give you the mentorship. We are definitely there to guide you. But we cannot spoon feed you, right? So efforts have to be come from your end as well. There has to be a collaborative effort between you and between me. Just me making all the efforts, or for that matter, faculties making all the efforts, will not enable you clearing the exam. Ultimately, it is you who's going to write the answers, right? So that difference has to be there. Your sincerity has to be much beyond than what we are expecting. So the first and foremost thing is that the syllabus has to be very clear. You have to be very thorough with each and every term in the syllabus. Is that clear? Take care. Next. There are a lot of terms, concepts in ethics. To be very specific, the vocabulary of ethics. You have to be very thorough with that. I'll tell you a difference. Now, again, I'm drawing the analogy with society. In society, we talk about gender stereotypes. Right? Very normally we use, it is because of patriarchy, because of gender stereotyping, or the prejudice which is existing in the society. Right? This is how we talk socialization. Ethics mein hum aise baat nahi karte. Ethics is, what is socialization? What are the agencies of socialization? How the socialization has been brought about? Are you getting my point? So you have to be clear. The conceptual understanding has to be very crisp. You have to be clear with each and every terminology. For example, when I say that there is prejudiced attitude in Indian society, it can be either based on gender or race or caste for that matter. But in ethics, you have to study what is attitude. What is prejudice? When your attitude is negative, irrational, then it is known as prejudice, right? So prejudice is based on something which is stereotype. Now, what is stereotype? Society mein hum sirf itna bol ke chhod dete the ki prejudice hai. There exist stereotypes. But what is stereotype? How stereotype develops? What needs to be done to overcome this problem of stereotyping? This is what has to be understood in the domain of ethics. Ethics may these terminologies, this vocabulary becomes of ultimate importance. And if you look at the questions, you will get an idea. They ask you direct question. What is difference between law and ethics? What is difference between rule and law? Are you getting the point? Okay. So you have to be very specific with these terminologies. What are components of attitude? Direct sawal puchte yaar, puchna hota hai to. So the point here is you have to be thorough with these vocabularies. And by making or by saying that you have to be thorough doesn't mean that you have to go about rote learning. Definitions yaad kar li. Nahi. Sirf learning the definition would not serve the purpose. You should be aware about not only the definitions, you also have to be aware about the manifestations, or for that matter, if there is specific characteristic features of that topic, and also the examples. An example from your everyday life. If you write examples from your everyday life, it adds value, richness to your content. Because many a times it happens that you and me may have the same source for the preparation of the content. We are going to the same institute, or we are picking up the same material from the market. Then how your answer would be different from the answers of others would be added what kind of examples, what kind of references you are making in your answer. For example, if you are quoting everyday life some anecdote, or you anecdote as an example, or you are talking about some real life leadership influence or inspiration that you have drawn, or you are mentioning some good work, case study ka matlab sirf wo case study us tarah se nahi, as in you are mentioning some examples of IAS officers, or for that matter administrative officials, or any leadership which have considerably influenced you. So these kind of examples or references to mythology, if you have interest, you can make references to it. Or you can also make references to different quotes or scholarly perspectives. Scholarly as in, because in your syllabus also you have moral thinkers. So you can make use of these things in order to enrich your content, and this fodder has to be prepared beforehand. I don't know why I end up teaching those subjects which don't have a standard book. So again, ethics also, you don't have a standard book. Obviously, you can make references to the books in the market, but then you don't have a one particular standard book, right? So you have to create this fodder. So this is what I mean when I say your terms and concepts have to be clear. What do you mean by values? Sirf keh dene se ki traditional values are undergoing a change. That would not serve the purpose. You should be having the clarity that what do you mean by values? Is that clear? What is the difference between values and belief? How values are different from attitude, or how values is different from morals and ethics? These are basic nuances. Then not only this, what are the characteristic feature of values? I'm giving you an example that how the fodder has to be prepared. So prepare, what do you mean by values? I'm just giving you an example. What do you mean by features of values, as in characteristic features? Examples of values. How value can be different from morals and ethics? How value is different from attitude? Is that very clear? So this kind of understanding will not come with rote learning. There has to be conceptual clarity. Only then the application would be possible. And if you look at the question, half of the questions, if are on theoretical lines, half of the questions would be on application based. Is that clear? And in fact, the understanding about these concepts and remembering, obviously rote learning is very different, but then you have to remember. Definitions should be on your tips, because you don't have time, you don't have space, much space to write the answer. So you cannot beat around the bush. So definitions have to be clear, that how values means the worth that you allocate to something. Is that very clear? Or values are based on the preferences, based on desirability or undesirability. So ye definitions aapko yaad honi chahiye. These are the guiding principles. Similarly, ethics, you should remember what is the definition of ethics, how ethics is different from morality. Ye basic conceptual understanding hai, along with examples. Example, where something can be moral but not ethical. Similarly, something which is ethical but is not moral. And you can have to establish these interrelationship. Something which is legal but not ethical, and something which is ethical but not legal. So these kind of interrelationships ke liye example have to be prepared beforehand. Obviously, this is not for the teaching purpose, otherwise I would have taught you in detail, but I'm just giving you an idea that how the fodder has to be prepared. Is that clear? Then there is a topic in your syllabus, when the socialization topic, in which it talks about the leadership. Obviously, socialization is induction of a child into society's culture. Okay, that is what is socialization. When I make you aware about the value system of the society, that is socialization. Now, since there are different agencies, one of the agency of socialization is leadership. So the teachings of the renowned leaders or influential leaders have to be prepared. तो अगर क्वेश्चन विवेकानंद पे आ जाए, महात्मा गांधी पे आ जाए, फॉर दैट मैटर सावित्री बाई फूले पे आ जाए, सो यू डोंट हैव टू बी कि अरे ये क्या पूछ लिया. Are you getting the point? It clearly APJ Abdul Kalam pe aa jaye, so there is clear specification that what is the role of leadership in socialization among the society. Is that clear? Or induction of a child into society's culture, what is the role of leadership? So you have to be prepared for such questions. And at least if you know that some leader was in news, theek hai, ab Vivekanand pe agar ji pe agar topic aata hai, so it is not very surprising. Swami Vivekanand pe, we were expecting a question. Right? So in such capacities, you cannot be like, "Arey, I didn't prepare for this." You have to be prepared for this. And ye mat sochna ki too much efforts are required. It is 250 marks. You cannot take it lightly. And if you prepare, for example, these leadership, do you really think that you will be limited to ethics paper? Absolutely not. This will help you building the content in essay also. This might help you in writing good introduction or conclusion in your other GS papers, as well as your optional, depending upon, it is not maths, chemistry or physics for that matter. Is that very clear for everyone, what I'm saying here? So the second thing is, you have to be very clear with respect to the terminologies, concepts, and not only with respect to definition, but also features, manifestations, and examples. And examples can be given in any which capacity, totally your choice. Is that very clear? Theek hai. Third thing. The reference point, previous year questions. Now, as far as ethics is concerned, 2013 mein introduced hua hai, so 2013 onwards. But I know it might be taxing for many of you, so at least make it a point that 5 years of previous year questions have been solved by you. And please do not go in the market and look for model answers. There is nothing called model answers for that matter. Is that clear? Only a guidance can be given to you that this is how the questions can be approached. That's it. Is that clear? ठीक है. So what I'm trying to say is previous 5 years, obviously you must be looking for some guidance, some mentorship. और आजकल तो net पे इतना content है यार. So if you look at previous year questions, just try to solve. In fact, I think we have also done the analysis. Yeah, we do the analysis of previous 5 year questions. You can refer to that session. I think Aditya sir took that session. I'm not sure last year he liya, I think. So you can just look on YouTube for the session and then you can make references to those. At least you will get an idea how to approach those questions. Is that very clear? Plus, please remember, previous year questions are indispensable part of your preparation because UPSC tends to repeat. There is a basic tendency, and in fact, if they do not exactly repeat the question, they definitely give you an idea that this is the line on this is how, or this has to be the line of thought to be very precise. Is that very clear? ठीक है, so you have to be very thorough with this. There is just no excuse of not solving previous year questions, and I'll tell you the excuse that most of us come up with. I have given this excuse like n number of times, and that is, let me first prepare and then I will solve the question. So then I will look at these questions. Wo preparation kabhi puri hoti nahi hai. We never get the time to solve the questions and directly we enter the examination hall with the spirit, array, we will clear the exam in the very first shot. Many of us do also. But the point is not that. Point is that is not the right way of approaching this exam. You have to understand it's a competitive exam. It is not graduation or school exam where you can, you know, complete the syllabus, then you can revise the syllabus also, and then you can go full prepared. Okay, these are the set of questions which can be expected. Aisa nahi hota yaar. It's a competitive exam. And why am I emphasizing on this? Because I was the victim of this kind of thought process. I always had this issue that since I was academically a good student, so the point is, I was always in this impression that I have to finish the syllabus. I have to complete the syllabus, I have to revise, and I have to go fully prepared in the examination. I did not understand that full preparation in competitive exam is not about completing the syllabus. Because wo time to kabhi aata hi nahi hai. You never intend to complete the preparation. You can never say for a competitive exam, oh, I am fully prepared. That is only in your mind. तभी तो इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस इतना जरूरी है. आई लव दिस पेपर. एथिक्स इज वंडरफुल टू टीच बिकॉज इट एक्चुअली मेक्स यू अ गुड ह्यूमन बींग. एंड नॉट ओनली गुड ह्यूमन बींग, इट मेक्स यू रैशनल. एंड फॉर दिस एग्जाम तो इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. यू हैव टू बी रैशनल दैट लुक, इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल टू कंप्लीट द एंटायर सिलेबस, सो वन शुड नॉट वेट फॉर दैट. यू शुड ऑलवेज कीप ऑन सॉल्विंग द क्वेश्चन साइमल्टेनियसली. इफ यू रीड अ पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक, जस्ट ट्राई टू फिगर आउट द क्वेश्चन आस्क्ड फ्रॉम दोज टॉपिक्स एंड अकॉर्डिंगली सॉल्व देम. सो एवरी डे आंसर राइटिंग हैज टू बी डन. वो एक टाइम, एक मुहूर्त निकालते हैं हम, उस दिन से हम आंसर राइटिंग करेंगे. और जैसे जैसे वो दिन आता है, वी कीप ऑन पोस्टपोनिंग. प्लीज डोंट डू दैट. आई नो आई हैव डन इट एंड आई थिंक मेनी ऑफ यू वुड रिलेट टू इट. वी हैव दिस हैबिट, कल से करेंगे. अच्छा चलो आज का दिन रहने देते हैं, कल से करेंगे. वो कल कभी आता ही नहीं है. दैट टुमोरो नेवर कम्स. सो दैट इज मेजर प्रॉब्लम विथ अस. इज दैट क्लियर? सो प्लीज फोकस ऑन प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस. It is an indispensable part, quote unquote. You have to solve previous 5 year questions, and not only with respect to ethics, all the subjects. But yeah, ethics and essay are very important. Essay mein ek at least idea lag jata hai that how to approach, what kind of topics have been asked. But ethics mein to mandatory hai. It is mandatory that you have to solve. ठीक है. And the fourth pillar for the preparation is answer writing. You really think that you can escape this process? Absolutely not. I think I've said it before also, and I'll again reiterate, that's my favorite quote. It's a quote by Stephen King. I love this quote because that is too true, that I write to know what I think. So until and unless you do not write, you will not even realize what is your actual thought process. And no matter how your thinking is in the right direction, your approach to the questions is in the right direction, ultimately it is the script which has to reflect your intention. If your intention is not getting adequately reflected in your script, it's no point, because ultimately examiner is just going to read your script. So if it is not, or he is not convinced with your approach or your style of answer writing, any amount of effort will not give you the desired result. एग्जैक्टली बहुत बार होता है ना, आप सोच कुछ रहे हो एंड व्हेन यू गेट डाउन टू राइटिंग देन देयर आर लॉट ऑफ टर्म्स व्हिच गेट्स एस्केप्ड, देयर आर लॉट ऑफ थॉट्स व्हिच आर लॉस्ट इन ट्रांसलेशन. सो मेनी अ टाइम्स इट हैपेंस. सो यू हैव टू प्रैक्टिस आंसर राइटिंग. मेक अ प्रॉमिस टू योर सेल्फ. टेक दिस प्लेज दैट एवरी डे एटलीस्ट टू आंसर्स आई एम गोइंग टू राइट. Every 10th day, I am going to write a mock test. Make a promise to yourself. And trust me, boon boon se ghada bharta hai. Ek hi din mein you would not become a prolific writer or you would not emerge as the most, intelligent student or the aspirant for that matter. There are a lot of effort which needs to be put in, right? So make a promise, make a pledge that every day two answers have to be written, come what may. Every 10th day, 7th day, 15th day, whichever level of preparation you are in, you have to promise that you will take a mock test. Make a promise every month you will write an essay. Main to roz likhne ko bhi nahi keh rahi hu, hafte mein bhi nahi keh rahi hu, month mein hi ek essay likh lo. So that by the time you are writing your mains, at least you have written 11 essays. So that is what my request is. Is that very clear? Theek hai. Similarly, it goes for ethics also. Write answers. Practice case studies. Make sure you write 100, 150 case studies have been practiced before you are sitting in the mains examination. I'm very sure out there most of you join some or the other test series. Many of you do not join test series also for some reason. But absolutely no issues. You have the availability of the question paper in the market. You have the availability of the answer formats in the market. You can make references to it. In fact, if you talk about vision only, so if you are a student of this year's test series, I'm giving you an example, you can also make references to previous year questions of vision test series. You will have a considerable fodder at your disposal, and accordingly you can channelize your preparation. The more the questions you solve, more you get the hang of the subject. Is that clear? You have to learn the terminology, the vocabulary. And for that, I will tell you, if you really think that this is becoming taxing, absolutely not. The moment you start, the only problem is to start. Once you get started, then journey is not at all difficult. Trust me. Is that clear? That was your initial inertia, hai na, that needs to be broken. Once it is broken, then it becomes very interesting. And ethics is it is a very interesting subject. Take it seriously. And if you really want to understand that how the answer writing has to be done, to hamare wo resource tab mein hai na topper script. To topper script mein just go and look for their ethics script. You will get an idea how they are approaching. Is that clear? To wo thoda apna sa lagta hai, acha ye kar paaye to hum bhi kar payenge. So make your reference points. Theek hai? And then try to, and please do not try to imitate. Try to get inspiration. Because each one of you have your own strengths. And please remember, before I start the official session, please remember that's a statement which is given by Aristotle. Self-awareness is beginning of all wisdom. So let's start the session on this note that self-awareness is the beginning of all wisdom. You have to be aware about your strengths and weaknesses. And how will you get to know about it? The moment you write the answers, the moment you approach the case studies, you will get an idea what is your area of strength and what is your areas of weaknesses. And if you look at topper's talk, or if you listen to topper's talk or look at their scripts, do not try to imitate them. Because they have altogether a very different background, they have different journeys, they have different strengths and weaknesses. But do make those things as your reference point. You can draw inspiration that, acha, this is my comfort area. For example, I was never comfortable in paragraph writing. I was more comfortable in making flowcharts, making bullet points. That is my area of expertise. So I play around my strengths, right? And very soon it became the USP that ma'am to flowcharts banake karti hai. Aisa nahi tha ki wo meri strength thi. And I made it a conscious effort to play around my strengths. There might be many of you who do not have that strength, who are more comfortable in paragraph writing. Feel free to go for it. Absolutely no issues. I still cannot make India's map, but there are many of you who can make India's map. Make use of India's map in having diagrammatic representation. Are you getting the point? So everyone has their own. I am very quick in learning the quotations, as you can see. I make sure I make use of these quotations because that is my strength. I am very comfortable. Maybe that is not your strength. Maybe your strength is quoting facts. Maybe your strength is storytelling, anecdotes. Maybe your strength is reading books about different leaders. So automatically your strengths has to be reflected in your answer writing. And that would only be known to you when you put in the effort. So self-awareness is beginning of all wisdom. Don't worry about those things which are not in your control. Worry about those things which are in your control. Theek hai? Chalo. Let's start with the questions. I have 6 questions to discuss with you very quickly. Let's start. Screen dikhaiye na. So the first question we are taking up, what are the main factors responsible for gender inequality in India? Discuss the contribution of Savitri Bai Phule in this regard. 10 marker question hai. The question can be divided into 2 parts. Obviously, that is quite obvious. 5 marks, let's take this assumption, is for the first part of the question and 5 marks for the second part. Now, when you make this subconscious division of marks, that can also be on the basis of the content that you have. Maybe you have more content to write about the factors responsible for gender inequality, and you have, or you have more content about contribution of Savitri Bai Phule. So that kind of variation is accepted. 40-60 ka ratio kar sakte ho, 50-50 ka ratio kar sakte ho, but aisa na ho ki 20-80 ka ratio ho jaye. So obviously you will lose out on marks. So there has to be prioritizing of the content in the right direction. It's a direct question. Again, if you have seen our previous sessions, I make it very clear that you have to write an introduction, there has to be a linking statement, there has to be a body, there has to be a conclusion. And these 4 structural bifurcations should be clearly, it should be explicitly known to the examiner that you are making a conscious effort in order to structure the answer. Now, as far as introduction is concerned, it clearly says that there is gender inequality. They are not asking you that whether there is gender inequality or not. It's a direct question. There is no rocket science or the catch in this question. It's a very basic question. So, pata hona chahiye ki gender inequality is in India. Now, the easiest way of substantiating your argument is by making use of statistics. So, instead of explaining what is gender inequality, I think it would be more as in advisable that we can make use of some statistics. And kyunki specific in India hai, that is why global gender gap report or the dimensions with respect to Indian context has been taken care of. For example, you can exemplify that how global gender gap index says India's ranking is 112 out of 153, and gender inequality is existing across all the dimensions, whether it is education, it is political empowerment, health, survival or economic participation. Is that clear? ठीक है. इन केस अगर जनरल क्वेश्चन आता जेंडर इनइक्वालिटी पे और स्पेसिफिक नहीं होता इंडिया में, तो आप और भी इंडेक्स यूज कर सकते थे. अब जैसे रिसेंटली यूएनडीपी फॉर द वेरी फर्स्ट टाइम हैज कम अप विद जेंडर सोशल नॉर्म इंडेक्स, वेयर दे हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट हाउ सोशल बिलीव्स व्हिच आर एग्जिस्टिंग इन द सोसाइटी दे ऑब्स्ट्रक्ट जेंडर इक्वालिटी. And how they have surveyed 80% of the population in the world, and they have come to the conclusion that more than 50% believe that men are better political leader or superior political leader as compared to women. 28% of them believes it is absolutely fine for men to beat their wife. 40% absolutely believe that men are better executives in the corporate industry as compared to women. So if in the question, you can also make use of this index, that is gender social norm index, which is published by UNDP. This is how the prelim specific information also comes handy when you write your mains answers. Now obviously the linking statement that this global gender gap index says it will approximately take 100 years to bridge the inequality or the gap which is existing with respect to gender, and this gender inequality is existing due to following factors. Directly you link the linking statement to the demand of the question. Now what are the factors? This is how you can introduce or incorporate diagram in your answer, totally your wish. ठीक है. सो सोशियो पोलिटिकल कल्चरल इकोनॉमिक फैक्टर्स रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर जेंडर इनइक्वालिटी. सी मेनी ऑफ अस अप्रोच द क्वेश्चन डायरेक्टली राइटिंग द फैक्टर्स विदाउट सेग्रीगेटिंग. ऐसा कुछ नहीं है कि हार्ड एंड फास्ट रूल है दैट यू हैव टू सेग्रीगेट, बट वंस यू सेग्रीगेट द थिंग इज देयर इज कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव कवरेज. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल इट मेक्स योर आंसर मोर स्ट्रक्चर्ड, एंड थर्ड यू डोंट एज इन लीव आउट ऑन इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स, एंड देयर इज नो रेपिटिशन ऑफ पॉइंट्स ऑल्सो. ठीक है. Then there are different factors. Now since it is an ethics based paper, it is important you make use of the terminologies which are there in your syllabus. For example, make use of stereotypes, make use of prejudices, make use of patriarchy, institutionalization of patriarchy. Is that very clear? Theek hai. Customs, practices, patriarchal values for that matter. These kind of terms should be incorporated. There has to be a conscious effort so that the question does not look very basic. It looks like a question which is from the, or the answer has been written in the ethics paper. The answer is right in front of you. That is social institutionalization of patriarchy, obviously, practice of dowry, which makes women appear as an economic liability. Then there is gender-based violence because of the stereotype which is existing in the society that women by very nature are weak, passive and dependent. This is also one of the result of gender inequality, or this also results into gender inequality in the society. Then because of the stereotypes which is existing, because of the gender-based stratification that is existing, there is lack of access to various resources. There is lack of autonomy with respect to decision making. So these are the social factors. Then if you look at the economic factor, we have already talked about, because of the stereotype which is existing. Abhi maine baat kari na gender social norm index, where it clearly says that women are less competitive as compared to men when it comes down to the executive domain. Theek hai? So because of various gender stereotypes, for example, there is a gender stereotype that women are good with soft skills. So there are certain specific jobs which are reserved for women, that is pink collar jobs. So you have to complete this understanding that it is because of the gender stereotype which is existing in the society. There is a stereotype that women makes emotional decision rather than rational decision. Hence women are not promoted beyond a certain level in any of the organization, and that is nothing but glass ceiling. So that is transparent ceiling which is existing in every organization, and it is based on the stereotype that women makes emotional decision rather than rational decision. So I am making references here to that concept of stereotypes. Is that clear? There exists prejudice against women, and because of that prejudiced attitude, for the same work men is paid more as compared to women. So there is a problem of wage gap, which results overall, it results into feminization of poverty. That if you have certain people below poverty line, then out of those people 70% of them are women. There is lack of financial inclusion. Again, that it is based on the stereotypes that women are not rational, so they are not being given access to the credit facilities, for that matter. They don't have autonomy with respect to economic decisions. They don't have control over their finances, and which has also been reflected by National Family Health Survey Report number 3, which says that 89% of the women do not have the autonomy to spend the money that they themselves are earning. Is that very clear? Theek hai. So agar ye topic ko dekha jaye, so this is a very direct question, but make sure that you are making references to stereotyping, you are making references to prejudiced attitude, you are making references to patriarchal value system which is existing in the society, you are making references to religious customs, practices, ideologies. It gives an ethical connotation to your answer writing. Similarly, cultural factor clear hai. Because of gender stereotyped attitude exist karta hai, to inequality hai. In fact, this gender stereotyping has various manifestation. One of the manifestation is cultural manifestation. The value system imparted to a girl child and a boy child is also very different. Why? Because there is gender stereotyping, and that forms the basis of socialization in the society. In fact, the career choices of the girls are also very different from boys. The aspiration, the behavior of the girls are also very different from the boys. The value system is also very different from the boys. Why? Because difference in the process of socialization. And why there is a difference in the process of socialization? Because of the notion of gender stereotyping. Is that very clear for everyone? See, we are here not to teach, but I just hope that you are getting an idea. Nahi to is ek question pe main ek lecture le sakti hu, theek hai? So thoda sa time restriction hai, lekin I hope that you are getting an idea that in what direction I'm asking you to approach the answer. Theek hai? Then perpetuation of patriarchy because of various religious customs and practices. In fact, if you look at various religious customs and practices, they are also legitimization of patriarchal mindset. Is that very clear? So that is also one of the problems. Ignorance and internalization of patriarchy. Obviously, women are not aware. They are not being aware that they've been discriminated. And in fact, there is internalization. They themselves perpetuate the patriarchy. That is why it is still persisting in our society. Women themselves don't realize. Is that clear? In fact, Gender Social Norm Index says that 90% of the total people that they surveyed, they have biasness against women. And those 90% definitely includes women as well. So women themselves have biasness against women. So there is internalization of patriarchy. You don't even realize that you are discriminating against women. Then obviously political factors are equally responsible. Why they are responsible? Because there is lack of representation of women in the political sphere. So obviously, aisa nahi hai ki women-specific decision making is not happening in India. But when you do not have adequate representation at the decision making level, then often it is perceived that women are the passive recipient of the benefits rather than active participant. So that notion also needs to undergo a change. Is that very clear? So these are the factors which are responsible. And obviously, I don't expect you to write every point which I've mentioned here. If you've written half of the point also, you will manage to score marks. Okay? Then there is another part to the question, and you don't have to beat around the bush because we don't have the space. So linking para and all that is not required. Directly come. Yehi fayda hota hai subheadings ka. I am very pro subheadings because subheadings not only gives a very unique touch to your answer writing, and sometimes when you make interesting subheadings, for example, globalization colon double-edged sword, perish or peril, theek hai, is tarah ka, silver lining in the dark cloud. Are you getting the point? When you make use of these kind of subheadings, it gives a very unique touch to your answer writing. So I am all in favor. All that glitter is not gold. Matlab, if you have to write, you've written the positives and not, now you have to write the limitations, and when you give the heading, all that glitter is not gold. So it gives that touch to your answer writing, which gives a very unique character to it. So I'm all pro for subheadings, and also it helps you saving some time. And there is a smooth transition from one aspect of the answer writing to another. Is that clear for everyone? So contribution of Savitri by Phule, you can absolutely, it's a direct question. Either you know or you don't know. And I expect that we all should know. Okay. So yeah, it is a direct question. Savitri by Phule had made a significant contribution in the field of education and also the liberation of oppressed or marginalized for that matter. In fact, she believed that education is the most important instrument which can result into liberation of oppressed. And that is one area that she has worked. Is that clear? Not only this area, she was an ardent feminist who has worked for the empowerment or emancipation of women. In fact, she established what is known as Mahila Seva Mandal to raise the awareness with respect to women rights in the society. Is that clear? So you can make references to this, that how she has contributed in the field of education, how she believed that education can be the most important instrument for the liberation of the oppressed class. You can talk about that how she was an ardent feminist who has worked for the emancipation of women. She has established what is known as Mahila Seva Mandal, where the purpose was to generate awareness with respect to women rights. Is that clear? In fact, she was a very good writer. She was a poet also, and she wrote a poem titled Go Get Education, where she has emphasized upon the importance of the education. Then she was also very active in campaigning against the evil of child marriage. She also advocated widow remarriages. In fact, she also opened the shelter because she wanted to prevent infanticides. So she also opened women shelters in order for the prevention of infanticide. All of that can be written. You can talk about how, along with Jyotirao Phule, she started what is known as Satya Shodak Samaj, where the emphasis was laid on the practice of Satya Shodak marriages, which is free from the intervention of priest, which would not be carried out on the common rituals, where there would not be the practice of dowry. So all of that was emphasized upon. So whether it is girl education, whether it is liberation of the oppressed class, whether it is working for the marginalized section, or going against or raising concerns against child marriage, widow remarriages, all of that can be written. And not only this, what is the learning lesson from her is also that a man of courage makes majority. I know it in itself, this statement is very gender stereotyped. I should have said woman of courage makes the majority. But anyhow, the statement says man of courage makes the majority. As in, if you are a courageous person, if you are a person high on self-efficacy, if you have internal locus of control, automatically you can bring about social transformation. You are not afraid of the crisis. Is that very clear? Is it very clear? So in fact, there was an incident which was said that when she used to go to school to teach the students, so every day she used to carry an extra sari with her. because she was so much ostracized, ridiculed, the cow dung used to be thrown at her, and she was the victim of verbal, physical abuses also. So all that, despite all that adverse circumstances, she still managed to bring about social reform in the society. So that is what it is said, that a man of courage makes the majority. Is that clear? So you can make references to these things. Everything was not possible to incorporate in this statement. That is why I'm saying in the discussion aspect. And she was an exemplification of a strong-willed, dedicated person who worked for the upliftment of marginalized in the face of opposition or oppression or ostracization. Savitri Bai Phule was a visionary who visualized gender justice through various activities by civil society and state. Conclusion. You could have written any conclusion for that matter. A man of courage makes the majority can also be a conclusion. In fact, mujhe hamesha lagta that can be a personal choice also. That these quotations come very handy. Wo jo last mein nahi hota ek punchline dene ke liye. So these quotations can come very handy. Again, your individual choices. Chalo. Let's take another question. Next question. Education is not an injunction. I hope the first question is clear for everyone. Education is not an injunction. It is an effective and pervasive tool for all-round development of an individual and social transformation. Examine new education policy in the light of the above statement. Yaar, ye new education policy favorite ho gaya hai is bar UPSC ka. Social justice also, I've discussed the answer with you if you remember. We discussed that the question was new education policy in congruence with sustainable development goal number 4. And also it has resulted, or it will result into restructuring and reorienting the education system in India. So if you look at the question, the only difference is in both the question they're talking about new education policy and its provisions. But the only difference is there they were asking you to compare it with sustainable development goal. And here they are asking you in the light of the statement, right? So please remember, when in the context of something, in the light of something, agar koi question aata hai, so that has to be explained in the introduction. So in the introduction, the statement has to be explained. Is that very clear? So if I go by the literal interpretation of injunction, so it is nothing but a court order which requires a person to do or cease doing a specific action. Either it is a court order which is asking you to do a specific action, or it is seizing you from performing that specific action. So this is the literal interpretation of injunction. But if I look in this context of the question which has been asked, it is more that education by means of authority orders. Is that very clear? That is, the education system would be top down, it would be centralized, one size fit all approach. It would be seen as a diktat which is given by the state. It would be considered as a means to avail livelihood opportunity. So it would be a very structured, top down, centralized, rigid system which is existing. So injunction would be seen in the context of education as education through authority orders, or in simple terms, coercive learning, forceful learning. You've been made to learn something which you might not be interested in. Jaisa hamara education system hai. You have to choose this subject because there is no other subject to be taught in the school, or you don't have the faculty for other subjects. Then there are very rigid combinations which are existing. What if I want to study maths with sociology? Maybe if I would have been given the choice that there is no strict compartmentalization of science, arts or commerce for that matter, there could have been combination of subjects which I would have studied. So the point here is coercive learning, education through authority orders. Is that very clear? Now, in this introduction, you will establish the fact that how education is an important component of promoting social as well as individual well-being. It should not be conceived as a diktat. That is, it should not be considered as the orders by the authority to get livelihood opportunity. In fact, on the contrary, it should be treated as an instrument to develop an overall personality of an individual, to develop an individual who is thoughtful, who is driven by the spirit of inquiry, scientific temper, rationality, creativity, innovation, courage, all of that. Is that very clear? In fact, here you can make references to the statement, the quotation which is given by Nelson Mandela also, that education is the most powerful tool which can be used to bring about social change. Because if you look at the statement, it clearly talks about social transformation. that education is perceived as a most important tool which can be used to bring about social transformation. So education should not be having a narrow interpretation where it is perceived as a means to attain livelihood opportunity or social status in the society. In fact, it should be seen as an opportunity or a medium to create or to transform human resource into human capital. It should be treated as a means to create a society which is virtuous, to create a society which is driven by scientific temper, which is driven by the spirit of critical inquiry, where the individual is not focused or limited with rote learning, but there is application. So, yahan pe nai taleem concept of Mahatma Gandhi can also be referred. Nai taleem mein bolte hai na, total personality development, work-centric education, education by means of vernacular medium. Why? Because it is said that the education is the most effective pervasive tool. Agar right kind of education in the right direction is being given. Obviously, agar hame right kind of education milegi, to we will be aware, we will be rational, we will be compassionate, we will be tolerant of diversity, accommodative of diversity. It will create a better society. There will be better social harmony in the society. And in fact, if you are educated on rational lines, you will be questioning the orthodox regressive practices in the society, and you will make an effort to bring about social transformation. And how will you do all of this when you've been made aware of it? And what is the process of giving you that kind of awareness? Education. So education is the most effective and pervasive tool to bring about the overall development. Hence, education should not be perceived in a narrow domain or in narrow capacity. In fact, it provides you an opportunity for social mobility. It helps in generating values of empathy and compassion, which can bring about social transformation. Is that clear? So the purpose of education, agar dekha jaye simple terms mein, it should be willful participation. People should come together willingly. So the approach should be that learning is such that you create an enabling environment where individuals' potential can be fully developed. So that is the objective of education. So education is not an injunction. I am explaining this, that education should not be conceived in a parochial capacity. It should be seen as a medium. And who is seconding this thought? In fact, Mahatma Gandhi by means of Nai Taleem, or Nelson Mandela through that quotation, has seconded this thought. Is that very clear? New education, obviously linking statement has to be there. New education policy aims to impart or ensure multidisciplinary or holistic education. What are the provisions? You have to directly list the provisions. The provisions which will ensure that the education system becomes comprehensive. It contributes to vocational learning. It contributes to better learning outcome. It helps in bridging the gaps which are existing in the society. So keeping these things in your subconscious mind, you can list the provision. Now here the challenge, agar koi hai, waise toh ye bahut hi simple question hai, but agar challenge aata hai, toh wo aayega explanation of the statement in the introduction. That can be a challenge. So we have seen how it has to be done. And second challenge would be, which provision should be listed? Sare provision to likhne nahi hai, so you have to prioritize. Is that clear? So the provision is universalization of school education completely by 2030, because they want every child should be given the opportunity to learn and excel. Second, it also talks about that the problem of equity needs to be corrected. There has to be universal accessibility to the education system. So it talks about bridging the social gap. Aisa nahi hai, pehli baar they have spoken about it. Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, Samagra Siksha Abhiyan, every scheme has talked about bridging the social gap. They have just reaffirmed it. And how? By incorporating the concepts of gender inclusion fund or special education zones for socio-economically vulnerable sections. Then there the rigid separation, jo main abhi baat kar rahi thi, science stream, arts, commerce, that will be done away with. Students will have the liberty to choose the subject. So autonomy would be there. There will be introduction of vocational education in schools. In fact, there would be internship with the local vocational trainers to give you hands-on learning experiences. Theek hai. The curriculum would also be reduced to the basic core essential of the subject, so as to make space or incorporate the possibilities of critical thinking, holistic inquiry based and analytical based learning. Is that clear? Similarly, there was a provision of experiential learning, that is learning through experiences. I remember when I was discussing social justice topic, I have mentioned this. So experiential learning is adopted by including hands-on learning, that if you are learning about animals, then you are going to the zoo rather than reading through books. So that is experiential learning. Ye bahut basic example hai. Then arts and sports integrated education. Dekha jaye to it is on the lines of Nayi Taleem. Theek hai. Then it also talked about that how higher order skills needs to be evaluated. Analysis or for that matter critical thinking. So the focus should be on competency rather than marks. They have also focused on improving the learning outcome. And one of the means of learning outcome is through artificial intelligence. So for that you have National Education Alliance for Technology, where the focus has been on improving the learning outcome by personalizing and customizing the education. In fact, here you can also talk or incorporate the education through mother tongue. Obviously, there would be better facilitation. In fact, jab hum linguistic reorganization ki baat kari thi, then also the leadership says that if you want universalization of education or you want to have massive spread of education, then it should be the educational instruction should be given in mother tongue. So that point can also be added. Is that clear? And then while concluding, you can very briefly talk about that the objective of new education policy is to provide affordable, relevant, qualitative, comprehensive, theek hai, education for overall holistic development of a child. So overall personality development, create a personality which is an asset for a society and not a liability. So moral education, value based education, comprehensive education, education based on vocational learning, all of that needs to be incorporated, multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary. So ek overall holistic development of a child would be ensured. If it is successfully implemented, it will successfully transform human resource into human capital. However, the success lies in uniform and transparent implementation at all levels. This is one of the criticism which has come, or one of the threat which is there, that since education is on your concurrent list, the overall thing can be there by the center, but the implementation still lies with the state. So it has to be ensured that there is uniform implementation, there is transparent implementation with equitable distribution of resources. Theek hai? Is that very clear? Again, I'm reiterating one thing. It is not the model or the best answer for that matter. I never take that, or I never put such kind of claims. The disclaimer is, it is just one of the approaches which can be used. That is why I'm trying to add more dimensions to it by means of discussion. Is that clear? Are we clear on this? Easy question tha. Next question. Okay. What are the main components of emotional intelligence? Can they be learned? Discuss. Now there are two parts to this question. Isse easy question nahi ho sakta hai, theek hai? And it is a very simple question, and this is directly from your syllabus. So syllabus mein de rakha hai emotional intelligence ka part, ki emotional intelligence in Indian context, emotional intelligence in administration, or the components of emotional intelligence, theek hai? Everything is there in your syllabus. So that was a direct question. So how you intend to start? Definitely with the definition. So now it depends upon you what definition you have to choose. I have written two definitions here. You can add more dimensions to it. Absolutely. Jo bhi aapka source of study hai, aap use kar sakte ho. So in simple language, if I have to say, emotional intelligence is nothing but ability to reason with emotions and to use emotions in reasoning. In fact, in today's time, emotional intelligence is the most relevant concept, because it actually emphasizes upon the role of emotions in the success and failure of an individual, whether at workplace or in general in your life. And this term of emotional intelligence has been popularized by Daniel Goleman, who is also known as father of emotional intelligence. So it is basically your EQ which is the major factor in your success rather than your IQ. Okay, so it has been established by Daniel Goleman. So either you write that it is an ability of an individual to reason with emotions or to use emotions in reasoning, or you can also talk about Mayer and Salve's the four branch model, where they have talked about emotional perception, emotional assimilation, emotional understanding, emotional management. Aur mujhe aisa kyun lag raha hai ki aapko ye sab pata hona chahiye? Matlab, I hope you are not expecting me to explain Mayer and Salve. अगर आपने इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस पढ़ा है तो ये पता होगा. मतलब बेसिक चीजें, हम दो ही चीजें पढ़ते हैं, डैनियल गोलमैन पढ़ते हैं या मेयर एंड साल्वे पढ़ते हैं. डैनियल गोलमैन ने पर्सपेक्टिव दिया है दैट व्हाट आर द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस व्हिच इज देयर इन योर डायग्राम. आई विल जस्ट कम बैक टू दैट पॉइंट. बट मेयर एंड साल्वे हैज ऑल्सो गिवन द फोर ब्रांच मॉडल ऑफ इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस, वेयर दे हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट दैट हाउ emotional intelligence is built or what are the components. So first, emotional perception, that you are self-aware about your emotions and you can express your emotions accurately. So that is nothing but emotional perception. Then after that, there is emotional assimilation, where you are aware about the different set of emotions. Ab aisa to hai nahi na ki at a particular time I have only one set of emotions which are governing me. There can be multiple emotions, so I am able to identify those different emotions at the same time. I'm also aware of the fact that which emotion is overpowering my thought process. For example, I can be sad, right? And because of the sadness, there is anger in me, right? So there are emotions which are there. Now, if I am aware of the fact that currently what I am going to do is actually facilitated by the emotion of anger, so that is emotional assimilation. Is that clear? That not only am I able to identify different set of emotions, but also able to identify which emotion is facilitating my thought process. That is emotional assimilation. Is that clear? Then third is emotional understanding. That see, emotion in itself is a very complex phenomena. Okay. So when you understand the complexity of emotions and also you are able to identify the transition from one emotion to another, that is emotional understanding. I am able to understand how I started with a, suppose your friend cheated you, duped you, deceived you. Obviously you were sad. And because of that sadness, then you became angry. How dare he do that? What is friends for? Are you getting the point? So if I'm able to understand this complexity of different emotions and also how the transition is happening from one emotion to another, then there will be the fourth stage, that is emotional management. So that is Mayer and Salve. So obviously the purpose was not to explain you this, but anyway, this is how it works. प्लीज बोर्ड क्लीन करवा दीजिए ना. यू कैन मेक अ फोर ब्रांच मॉडल. आई एम सॉरी द बोर्ड इज नॉट क्लीन बट आई एम स्टिल ट्राइंग टू मेक इट फॉर यू. क्लीन करिए बोर्ड पहले. ये जो अभी बनाया है ये छोड़ दीजिएगा बस. So either you can make this diagram also, that is nothing but Mayer and Salve. So you have emotional perception, assimilation, understanding and management. Is that clear? Screen dikhaiye. So this is clear, no? This is four branch model of Mayer and Salve as far as emotional intelligence is concerned. The second definition you can write, it's an ability of an individual to understand and not only understand, use as well as manage your own emotions in positive way, so as to relieve the stress, effectively communicate, empathize, diffuse any kind of conflict or overcome the challenges. So totally your choice how you want to write. Then what are the main components of emotional intelligence? So either you are talking about Mayer and Salve perspective or you are talking about the perspective of Daniel Goleman. So this is the perspective of Daniel Goleman, where he says there are five components of emotional intelligence, right from self-awareness, self-regulation, motivation, empathy and social skills. So not only you are going to make the diagram, you also have to explain. Now I have made it for you. ऐसे भी कर सकते हो, नहीं तो पैराग्राफ राइटिंग भी कर सकते हो, पॉइंट फॉर्मेट भी कर सकते हो. टोटली योर चॉइस, योर कॉल. सो सेल्फ अवेयरनेस, ऑब्वियसली यू शुड हैव द अबिलिटी टू रिकॉग्नाइज एंड अंडरस्टैंड योर ओन इमोशंस एज वेल एज द ड्राइवर्स ऑफ योर इमोशंस एंड हाउ दे आर हैविंग द इफेक्ट ऑन अदर्स. अ पर्सन हु इज सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंट, अ पर्सन हु हैज डन अ रियलिस्टिक सेल्फ असेसमेंट, वही स्ट्रेंथ्स एंड वीकनेसेस वाला, और हैज सेल्फ डेप्रिकेटिंग सेंस ऑफ ह्यूमर. It means that you are a person of self-awareness. Is that very clear? Similarly, self-regulation. You are able to control your impulses. You are able to manage your emotions. इन फैक्ट यू आर थिंकिंग बिफोर एक्टिंग. मेनी अ टाइम्स होता है ना, हमने गुस्से में रिएक्ट कर दिया, फिर आप घर जाके सोचते हो एंड देन यू रियलाइज व्हाई डिड आई रिएक्ट ओनली इन फर्स्ट प्लेस, इट वॉज नॉट इवन वर्थ रिएक्शन. Did you get my point? So that is the problem. At some point of time, we all lack what is known as emotional intelligence because we don't have control over our impulses. So self-regulation is very important. You should not be the prisoner of your own emotions. Is that clear? That is what is self-regulation. Then motivation. Your motivation, your passion to work should not be for some external factor, for example, to seek recognition or for monetary. It should be that you are passionate about doing it, with detaching yourself with the outcome of the work. You are doing the work for the sake of it, because you think it is the right thing and this is what you feel about it. So you should be passionate, you should be energetic, you should be persistent in pursuing your goals. So you should be motivated, and that is why, in fact, agar ye tum panch cheezes samajh lo na, UPSC journey also becomes easy. You have to be aware about your strengths and weaknesses, you have to regulate, you have to manage your emotions, you have to control your impulsive feelings, desires. Is that very clear? So that is what we mean. You should think before acting. You should have the propensity to hold judgments. You should not be judgmental. Is that very clear? Similarly, motivation. You should be motivated. You should have passion to prepare for this exam. You should be persistent in your efforts. Even though there might be certain incidences where you have not been successful, but that should not limit your efforts, or that should not be demotivating factor. So there has to be motivation. Empathy, very important. Stop pitying others. Stop sympathizing with others. What is required is empathy. Don't be judgmental about others. Just imaginatively place yourself in the shoes of other and try to reflect that why a person is acting in a certain manner. So that is empathy. That you are ability, or you have the ability to understand the emotional profile of others. You have the skill in treating people according to their emotional reactions. That is what is known as empathy. And finally, what you need to have is the social skill, that is relationship management. Social skills bahut important hoti hain. Agar topic hota to bata bhi deti what are the techniques of developing social skills, but today we don't have time for that. So basically, you should have the proficiency, you should have the knack for managing relationships, theek, or building networks or bonds. Social capital bolte na, networking. So that is social skills. Can EI be learned? A general perception is definitely there that early experiences of your life as well as your genetics play a very significant role in your ability to manage your emotions. However, having said that, emotional intelligence skills can be learned. They can be evolved, they can be developed. However, it depends upon certain factors. In fact, Daniel Goleman himself said that motivation is the most important thing so as to develop the skills of emotional intelligence. How can you be made emotionally intelligent person? You yourself have to be motivated. There has to be a conscious effort which has to be made. For example, I should know that if I have certain issues in managing my emotions, these are certain weaknesses. For example, I react too easily. ये मैं अपने बारे में नहीं बता रही हूँ, मैं एग्जाम्पल दे रही हूँ, डोंट जज मी ऑन दिस. सो आई रिएक्ट टू इजिली. सो इन दैट सिचुएशन यू हैव टू बी मोटिवेटेड. आई हैव टू डेलिबरेटली मेक अ कॉन्शियस एफर्ट टू इंश्योर दैट आई डोंट रिएक्ट इम्पल्सिवली, आई डू नॉट रिएक्ट इन हेस्ट. Is that clear? So that motivation has to be there. So learning EI skills require commitment. It requires consistent conscious practice to improve your emotional intelligence. You should have the willingness, honestly, to evaluate your emotions and drivers. For example, if you yourself cannot understand your own emotions, how do you will be able to understand and manage the emotions of others? And if you are going to be an administrator, this is the most important thing. You need to be an emotionally intelligent person. Otherwise, how will you tackle the crisis situation? If you are not emotional intelligence, how would you manage the farmers who are protesting? Do you really think that by using force or power you will be able to drive them off? Absolutely not. You have to be considerate, you have to be emotionally intelligent, you have to be tactful in managing the relationships with your subjects would not be the right word, with the citizens. Is that very clear? Theek hai. Then well-designed interventions has to be there. For example, you should have the clear picture that where or what areas needs to be improved. And then the specific behavior needs to be practiced, which will help in a very targeted improvement of your competence. Is that clear? You should be given, and for that, in order to have that clear picture that where you are lacking, there has to be an accurate feedback which has to be given to you that how others are perceiving you. Is that clear? So that you can self-reflect on your personality. You can pause and contemplate on your own behavior. Is that very clear for everyone? And for that, there can be a coach or trainer. In fact, Daniel Goleman says there is no harm in employing a trainer for this, which can help you or who can help you. Tabhi to keh rahe hain, aaj emotional intelligence should be made a part of your curriculum, school curriculum, because that has to be developed right from the beginning. Then most importantly, flexibility in attitude. Every individual cannot learn the skills of emotional intelligence. If you are very rigid, you don't have empathetic attitude, you are not aware about yourself, and you don't have social skills, then it becomes a challenge. Aisa nahi hai ki it will not be. If you have that will to change, then obviously any hurdle can be surpassed. But in case you are a person who already has some amount of social skills, who is self-aware, who is having more empathy towards other, then development of emotional intelligence skills would be an easy task. However, if you do not have these qualities, but you have the will to change and improvise, then also you can learn the skills. And finally, application, walking the talk. अब मैं आपको बता रही हूँ emotional intelligence means self awareness, regulation, motivation, empathy. क्या हो जाएगा मेरे बताने से आप emotional intelligent हो जाओगे या आपको बताते बताते मैं emotionally intelligent हो जाऊंगी? ऐसा तो कुछ नहीं होगा, right? You need to practice. It has to be reflected in your real life behavior. So whatever theories that you study, you learn, that has to be incorporated in your real life. Only then we can say that emotional intelligence would be developed. Is that very clear? And while concluding, you can add more points to it. For example, few says that effective communication, wo social skill ka hi part hai, but effective communication is required for development of emotional intelligence. Mindfulness is required. Mindfulness is more about meditation. As in, mindfulness says that you are aware about your current, present feelings, thoughts, without any judgment. So mindfulness can be very important. Effective communication can be very important in development of or building of emotional intelligence. Is that very clear for everyone? Theek hai. Now, the conclusion part mein, you can clearly talk about that how in the current context emotional intelligence becomes very important, especially in this virtual field that we are there. So chahe wo current life hai, where we are in virtual process of interaction, or it is your work life. So everywhere there is more virtual mode of interaction. So in that capacity, having awareness about how to manage the emotion of yourself as well as other is very relevant. Is that very clear? As a result, it should be a conscious effort to incorporate emotional intelligence in your everyday curriculum, specifically school level. So it says, rule your feelings lest your feelings rule you. Is that very clear? So again, that is what I meant when I say that punchlines are sometimes very handy. So there is a statement I think Aristotle gave, that it is very easy to be angry, but how to express your anger in the right degree, at the right time, in the right situation, against the right individual is a difficult task, and it should be learned. Theek hai? So that is what it means when we say that emotional intelligence. So rule your feelings. Instead of being the prisoner of your own emotions, you should rule your feelings. Otherwise, your feelings will start ruling you. And trust me, this is very important when it comes down to UPSC preparation also. That in fact, UPSC mein toh maine aksar dekha hai that we should have that spirit of controlling your impulses, controlling your emotions. In fact, on a lighter note, I'll tell you something. All your life, no matter how disciplined you have been, I don't know, something goes wrong with when we start preparing about UPSC. So no matter how disciplined or jo aap ek Zakir Khan ki language mein bolte ho ki sakht insaan hota hai, but sala jab UPSC ki preparation aati hai, aadhi janta ko mohabbat ho jati hai. So that is the major problem with UPSC. So and kabhi kabhi hoti bhi nahi hai, you start taking feel of it. So the point here is you don't realize what is your actual emotions. That was on the lighter note, that you should be an emotionally intelligent person. So rule your feelings. Otherwise, wo kya hota hai na, impulses, desires hote hain ki aap आधे तो फील ही ले लेते हैं दैट आई एम इन लव एंड हाफ ऑफ द प्रिपरेशन टेक्स द बैक सीट. यू बिकम द प्रिजनर ऑफ योर ओन इमोशंस. सो दैट इज वन वेरी बेसिक इशू विच मोस्ट ऑफ अस आउट देयर आर सफरिंग. प्लीज डू नॉट डू दिस. दिस प्रिपरेशन इज एन ऑल टाइम लाइफ एक्सपीरियंस फॉर यू. डू नॉट लेट गो ऑफ इट विदाउट ड्यू टू एनी फैक्टर फॉर दैट मैटर. ठीक है, बट फैक्टर हियर डजंट मीन लव रिलेशनशिप्स. फील वेलकम टू गेट इन टू दैट, बट मैं एक जनरल बात कह रही हूँ दैट ट्राई टू कंट्रोल योर इमोशंस, हैव बेटर अंडरस्टैंडिंग अबाउट योर इमोशंस. ठीक है, चलो लेट्स टेक द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन. ओके, आई जस्ट, देर इज सम इश्यू विद द पीपीटी, जस्ट गिव मी 2 मिनट्स. Okay, there is some problem with the PPT. There's one slide mein kuch problem aa raha hai, but anyway, let's discuss the question. The next question is, the current internet expansion has instilled a different set of cultural values which are often in conflict with the traditional values discussed. So the question that we have is that the current internet expansion has instilled a different set of cultural values which are often in conflict with traditional values discuss. Basically here, if the question, ye question could have been asked even in your society paper for that matter also. Theek hai. Dekhi screen pe dikh raha hai kya? Screen dikhaiye na. क्लियर नहीं आ रहा ना, ऐसा क्यों हो रहा है? एनीवे, लेट्स जस्ट सी, स्क्रीन ही दिखाइए फिर से थोड़ा सा, जो दिख रहा है उतने में मैनेज करते हैं. सो द करंट इंटरनेट एक्सपेंशन हैज इंस्टिल्ड, सो बेसिकली अगर ये एथिक्स के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से द आंसर हैज टू बी रिटन, वन थिंग कैन बी फोकस अपॉन हियर इज दैट यू स्टार्ट विद द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ वैल्यूज. नहीं तो पता कैसे चलेगा सोसाइटी का आंसर लिख रहे हैं या एथिक्स का. सो यू कैन स्टार्ट विद अ बेसिक डेफिनेशन ऑफ वैल्यूज, फॉर एग्जाम्पल लॉन्ग लास्टिंग बिलीव्स विद रिस्पेक्ट टू वॉट इज डिजायरेबल और अनडिजायरेबल, और यू कैन टॉक अबाउट दैट हाउ वैल्यू डिनोट्स प्रेफरेंसेज बेस्ड ऑन इंपॉर्टेंस, दैट इज द वर्थ दैट यू एलोकेट टू समथिंग. Right? Very simple understanding. This is also for your reference. You should know what are values. It is the worth that you allocate to something, or it is basically denoting the preferences with respect to desirability or undesirability, or with respect to importance. Now you need to understand, how do you get a certain set of values? You get your certain set of values by means of a process which is known as socialization, which I talked few minutes back, that how socialization is a process which gives you those certain set of values, right? Now that process of socialization, there can be different agencies. You can have media, you can have education, you can have workplace. These are the different agencies of socialization. Now because of internet, ठीक है, नाउ डू यू रियलाइज दैट बिकॉज ऑफ द इंटरनेट दीज एजेंसीज ऑफ सोशलाइजेशन देयर वैल्यू सिस्टम इज अंडरगोइंग अ चेंज. व्हाई? बिकॉज द प्रेफरेंसेस इज अंडरगोइंग अ चेंज. व्हाट इज कंसिडर्ड डिजायरेबल टुडे मे नॉट बी कंसिडर्ड डिजायरेबल टुमारो. सो व्हेन योर डिजायरेबिलिटी, योर प्रेफरेंसेस चेंजेस, योर वैल्यू सिस्टम इज अंडरगोइंग अ चेंज. एंड सिंस दीज एजेंसीज वैल्यू सिस्टम इज अंडरगोइंग अ चेंज बिकॉज ऑफ प्रोलिफरेशन ऑफ इंटरनेट, दैट इज ऑल्सो ब्रिंगिंग अबाउट चेंजेस इन द वैल्यू सिस्टम ऑफ द सोसाइटी. So you are developing those cultural values which is in conflict with the traditional values. Is that very clear? Theek hai. Now here the linking statement can be talked about that how recently the cultural values which are instilled, they are in contradiction with the traditional values. And very briefly you can mention about those traditional values. For example, collectivism, cooperation, non-violence, delayed gratification, family obligation, collective feeling, morality, decency. These were the traditional value system. Strong religious orientation. This is nothing but the value system. ठीक है, hierarchical something, hierarchy was preferred. So that was value and hierarchy on the basis of ascriptive criterias. The ritual values for that matter. ठीक है, Now, in the body, you will be talking about the justification of your statement. So you have to give examples to justify that how new set of value system has emerged, which is in contradiction with the traditional values. Here we are not talking about good values or bad values. We are only talking about new set of values are in conflict with the traditional values. For example, because of instilling of internet, there is new value system which is driven by consumerism, which is driven by materialism, especially with the proliferation of these shopping sites or the social media platforms. ठीक है, and it is in direct contradiction with the traditional value of non-ostentation or minimalism. Is that very clear? Similarly, there is increased incidences of porn viewership. There is online abuse, sexual harassment, which goes against the traditional values of decency, morality, restraint. So the new set of values which are emerging is objectification, commodification. So this objectification, commodification goes against the traditional values of decency, morality or restraint. Similarly, there has been increasing incidences of breakdown of joint families. There is increasing incidences of fulfillment of your personal vested self-interest, which is in conflict with the traditional value of collectivism. Is that clear? Now, the family values, the bonds which were given in the traditional setup was talking about more cooperation. But because of internet proliferation, the work culture is undergoing a change. There is more zeal towards competition. So obviously, the traditional values of cooperation is against the modern values of competition. The traditional value of collectivism is contravened by this individualism. So the value system is undergoing a change. Similarly, this concept of online dating, the concept of matrimonial sites, the concept of live-in relationship for that matter, is giving more primacy to the individual choices, the value of freedom, compatibility, choices, which is against the traditional values of family obligation for that matter. Is that clear? Similarly, you can add more points. Since we have added the point of competition and cooperation, you can also add the point with respect to religion for that matter, that with this internet proliferation, with more exposure to the Western thoughts, there is growing incidences of secularization, and because of which over encompassing religious values the values of strong religious orientation is undergoing a change. Is that very clear? So you can also pit that the new values, the secular values are emerging, which is in conflict with the traditional religious values. Is that very clear? Is it making sense? Okay. Now, along with that, there has to be a counter thought process also. Counter word kehlo ya alternative argument kehlo, that can also be mentioned, that how internet is not only generating new set of values, it is also leading to reinforcement of the traditional values. How it is leading to the new enforcement of the traditional values? It provides you the platform. It provides you the platform for unification. For example, some movie came or some statement was given which kind of hurt your religious or community sentiments. So media, the internet, it provides you the platform to unite. To unite on your cultural lines and to reinforce your traditional values. So internet by means of media is providing you that platform to unify on the basis of your caste, religion, community interest. Is that very clear? Similarly, these matrimonial sites, although they give you the alternative, but those matrimonial sites are also governed by religious notions, caste endogamy. So it further strengthens your traditional affiliation. Is that clear? Similarly, this internet also provides you the means to reinforce your traditional values. For example, spread of traditional medicinal system or dissemination of information with respect to religious beliefs, customs, festivals, etc. Is that clear? In fact, social media plays a very important role in developing the connect or linkages with your extended kins. So it helps in strengthening the familial values. Is that clear? Similarly, there have been various movements also initiated by means of internet, which helps in reasserting the traditional values. For example, environmental movement. It is reasserting the value, that is the importance for nature. So cleanliness is next to godliness for that matter. So the importance of nature, it helps in creating balance between the man and nature. And these kind of value systems have been reinforced by means of internet proliferation. Is that clear? So that is not only one side of the story, it has both the sides. ठीक है. सो यू कैन मेक अ कंक्लूजन. द स्टेटमेंट इज गिवन बाय मोहम्मद यूनिस दैट बाय इटसेल्फ टेक्नोलॉजी इज वेरी न्यूट्रल. इट डिपेंड्स अपॉन द यूज टू विच इट हैज बीन पुट टू और हाउ इट हैज बीन यूज्ड. सो बाय वेरी नेचर टेक्नोलॉजी इटसेल्फ इज न्यूट्रल. इज दैट क्लियर? So, internet can lead to both proliferation of new cultural values which are in conflict with the traditional values. At the same time, it can also help in strengthening the traditional values. Is this very clear for everyone? Is it making sense? Okay. Very quickly, let's take the next question. Hatred is destructive of person's wisdom and conscience that can poison a nation's spirit. Do you agree with this view? Justify your answer. So when the question says justify your answer, that means they are looking for example. One thing. Second thing is hatred is destructive of person's wisdom and conscience that can poison a nation's spirit. Now in this topic, since it again obviously कहीं और नहीं ethics में पूछा है, so you have to be clear with this idea of hatred. So in the introduction itself, you have to define this notion of hatred. ठीक है? So how hatred is a negative emotion. ठीक है. हाउ हेट्रेड इज समथिंग विच इज इरेशनल, विच इज डीप फीलिंग ऑफ एंगर इज एसोसिएटेड विथ इट. देर इज डिस्पोजिशन टूवर्ड्स होस्टिलिटी. हाउ इट इज रेफर्ड एज समथिंग विच इज डीप और एक्सट्रीम डिसलाइक विच कैन बी डायरेक्टेड. दिस फीलिंग ऑफ हेट्रेड इज नथिंग बट अ मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ एक्सट्रीम डिसलाइक एंड इट कैन बी टारगेटेड or it can be directed against either an individual or the entity or the object, or it can also be against the ideas. So that is what it means when we say hatred. Is that clear? Now just one before we proceed with this discussion, there was a topic now how emotional intelligence can be built. So there in that topic I said that as an example you can also give mythological references. So you can talk about Bhagavad Gita also. माइथोलॉजिकल से मेरा मतलब था कि हम क्योंकि बात करते हैं तो भगवद गीता में जब कृष्ण लॉर्ड कृष्णा वॉज गिविंग द टीचिंग्स टू अर्जुन सो देर ही टॉक्ड अबाउट दैट हाउ इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस कैन बी डेवलप्ड एंड ही गेव द आइडिया व्हेन ही टॉक्ड इन भगवद गीता ही टॉक्ड अबाउट निष्काम कर्म. ठीक है? दैट इज गेटिंग डिटैच्ड फ्रॉम द आउटकम ऑफ योर एक्शन. वंस यू बिकम डिटैच्ड फ्रॉम द आउटकम ऑफ योर एक्शन यू विल बिकम एन इमोशनली इंटेलिजेंट एंड अ स्टेबल पर्सन. दैट इज वॉट इट हैज बीन सेड इन भगवद गीता. इनफैक्ट भगवद गीता में देर इज अ टर्म विच इज मेंशन स्थित प्रज्ञ एंड दैट स्थित प्रज्ञ इज नथिंग बट इमोशनली इंटेलिजेंट पर्सन. सो ही सेड लॉर्ड कृष्णा सेड दैट वंस यू परफॉर्म निष्काम कर्म दैट इज डिटैचमेंट फ्रॉम द आउटकम्स ऑफ योर एक्शन यू बिकम एन इमोशनली इंटेलिजेंट पर्सन. सो वेन वी वर टॉकिंग ना हाउ इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस कैन बी बिल्ड यू कैन make this reference of how Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita had talked about Nishkam Karm. Is that clear? Karm kar phal ki ichha mat rakh. Is that clear? Chalo. Mujhe achanak se yaad a gaya, so I thought I'll mention that. Chalo, wapas question pe aao. Hatred. So yes, you have defined what is hatred and then you can talk about a general perception which exists in the society. The morals in the society, they always oppose hatred because it is believed once you become or you start hating someone, it shadows, it kind of overpowers your individual judgments and belief. Is that clear? In fact, since it is said that hatred and anger, ye ek relation hai primary secondary emotion ka. You can be angry and as a result you can hate someone. Or you hate someone and you can be angry, right? So this is a very primary or secondary emotion kind of a relationship. So in fact, again, I'll quote Bhagavad Gita here. So here Lord Krishna said that this feeling of hatred or the anger that is there, it is the reason for the ruining of an individual. In fact, this is also mentioned in the teachings of Buddha. That hatred is one of the reason why a person ruined himself. And the answer to hatred can never be hate. So hatred should always be appeased by love. Okay? And that is the eternal law. So that is what has been said in teachings of Buddha also. And in fact, in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that when you hate and when as a result there is anger in you. Hum kehte hai na ki hatred is very closely associated with anger. So here it has been said that when you start hating someone, it can be due to any factor. So when you hate someone, so it is associated with the emotion of anger. And once you are angry with someone or once there is that emotion of anger, then you become delusional. Isko samajhne ki koshish karna. You have that emotion of hate. You are hating someone. Theek hai? And someone, group, anyone. So idea. So when you have that feeling of hatred, it often results into a secondary emotion of anger. And once there is anger, you become delusional. Once you become delusional, then your capacity to discriminate between what is right and what is wrong, that gets crippled. So your wisdom gets crippled. Is that very clear? And when that feeling of hatred is not restricted only to the individual, as in I am not only carrying that feeling of hatred is all pervasive in the society, then it dampens nation spirit. The spirit of cohesion, the spirit of harmony, the spirit of peaceful coexistence, that gets hampered. Is that very clear? So hatred is a negative emotion which needs to be addressed because it is responsible for ruining of an individual. Duryodhan, give example. Kyun nahi de sakte ho aap ye sare examples? Duryodhan's hate for Pandav has resulted into vanishing of entire Kaurav empire. Is that very clear? So you can talk about all these things. Theek hai? You can make references to this. Theek? Chalo, let's get back to it. Then give examples to justify your answer. Obviously Hitler can be there, Mussolini can be there, that how their hatred towards certain community and institution has led to their downfall. And further you can explain that how when this feeling becomes, obviously I've already told this, that it becomes all pervasive, so it hampers social capital, harmony, peaceful coexistence in the society. Then since it is saying justifying, you can give specific example in context of Nazi Germany for that matter, that there was a strong resentment and hatred towards Jews. It started with their leader and it trickled down to the rest of the society. First, Jews were blamed for the defeat of Germany in World War I, which resulted into anti-Semitic programs were started, which finally culminated into Holocaust, one of the largest genocide in the history of world. Aisa nahi hai ki aap Indian context mein examples nahi de sakte the. Hum Muslim riots ki baat kar sakte the, hum anti-Sikh riots ki baat kar sakte the, but we will not be giving those examples. It is easy to take examples from the external factor. फिर क्या होता है ना कि कॉन्ट्रोवर्सीज नहीं रहती हैं, ठीक है? सो बहुत कन्वीनियंटली आप जर्मनी का एग्जाम्पल उठा के दे सकते हो, यहाँ पे कोई कॉन्ट्रोवर्सी नहीं रहेगी, ठीक है? अदरवाइज इन कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ इंडिया ऑल्सो देर आर सो मेनी एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ मॉब लिंचिंग, देर इज एग्जाम्पल ऑफ हेट स्पीच, देर इज एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ कम्यूनल रायट्स विच हैज नॉट ओनली इम्पैक्टेड द इंडिविजुअल बट हैज डैम्पन द नेशन्स स्पिरिट. So those examples can be quoted here. There are different factors that why that hatred feeling is existing, but one thing is for sure that when there is a feeling of hatred, ye link bitha dena, that it results into the emotion of anger, and once you are angry you become delusional, and once you become delusional your power to discriminate between right and wrong, it gets crippled, and which is one of the reason or most important reason for a downfall of an individual. Is that clear? फिर आप सोच नहीं पाते हो, फिर वो empathy, emotional intelligence, everything takes a back seat because you have now become delusional. However, you can give a counter argument also. Counter argument तो नहीं कहूंगी, एक supportive argument है that जो बुद्धा की teachings में भी mentioned है, that hatred cannot be appeased by hate, it has to be appeased by love. So there has to be a spirit of love and tolerance, and who is the epitome of this values? They have been Nelson Mandela, or for that matter Mahatma Gandhi. In fact, Nelson Mandela, for 3 decades he was being imprisoned by the white supremacist government. Despite that, he never had showed or he never had carried emotion of hate towards the white people, and that was one of the reason why the potential civil war was averted. Is that very clear? Similarly, Mahatma Gandhi, when partition happened on communal lines, he made a very deliberate effort to spread the message of love and tolerance among the different religious minority groups. Is that very clear? Is it making sense? Hence, in teachings of Buddha, I have already highlighted that how people ruin themselves because of hatred, and the only solution is loving kindness. ठीक है, अब पूछोगे लविंग काइंडनेस क्या है, नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन में डिस्कस कर लेते हैं. बुद्धा की टीचिंग्स पे ही क्वेश्चन है. सो कैन यू सी हाउ दीज आंसर्स आर रिलेटेड? सो विद दिस वी विल डिस्कस द लास्ट क्वेश्चन. व्हाट टीचिंग्स ऑफ बुद्धा आर मोस्ट रेलेवेंट टुडे एंड व्हाई? अब गांधी जी पे ये क्वेश्चन ऑलरेडी बन चुका है, ठीक है? सो इसी तरह से क्वेश्चन आते हैं कि रेलिवेंस ऑफ गांधी जी इन करंट सोसाइटी, सिमिलरली टीचिंग्स ऑफ बुद्धा आर रेलिवेंट टुडे, व्हाई, डिस्कस. सो ऑब्वियसली यू हैव टू स्टार्ट विद अ प्रीमाइस. So it can directly, और यहां पे बहुत स्कोप है, देख लो स्कोप कैसे है. बुद्धा हैज गिवन मोर देन 84,000 टीचिंग्स. तो कुछ तो आपको भी याद होगा, आर्ट एंड कल्चर वगैरह में पढ़ते ही हो, आई थिंक आप एंशियंट इंडिया बुद्धिज्म जैनिज्म करते हो, सो यू स्टडीड दैट, सो यू नो द टीचिंग्स. ऑल यू नीड टू डू इज व्हाटएवर दोज टीचिंग्स आर, pick out those teachings which can be made relevant in the current context. For example, you can start with the premise that it is said that Buddha gave more than 84,000 teachings, and the teachings were so extensive that every individual in different circumstances can find something which is meeting their particular needs. Then you can draw a linking statement that societies across the world are facing issues such as moral degradation, the corruption of moral fabric to be very precise. You have religious conflicts, there have been incidences of religious fundamentalism, there is corruption, there is a prejudiced attitude, the racial conflicts, the ethnic conflicts which are existing, there is environmental distress which is existing in the society, how the crime rate is increasing. Hence the value of compassion, peace, solidarity, peaceful coexistence, it assumes great relevance. In fact, international relations may be baat kar sakte ho, that how the only option to exist is peacefully coexist rather than aiming to destroy each other. So India China ke context mein pehle bhi bola hua hai ki there is enough space for India and China to mutually coexist, and the only option would be peaceful bilateral relations. So Buddha ke teachings ko waha international relations mein bhi you can apply. Then obviously body ki agar baat kare, to following teachings of Lord Buddha, it transcends the time and are still relevant. So how he said that ignorance is the root cause of all the suffering. So he clearly talked about how ignorance is the root cause of all suffering, how he has emphasized upon the importance of education for liberation. And education also, when he said that the learning should be based on one's observation, it should be based on perception. Knowledge is not possible without experience. So he had talked about it. So he is highlighting that education which is not based on rote learning, but the education or the learning which is based on experience. Aur aaj current context mein wo kitna valid hai. Experiential learning jo humne new education policy mein baat kari hai, wo isi ka to example hai. That ignorance is the root cause. And that is why WhatsApp University is existing, because you and me are unaware. So ignorance is the root cause of all the sufferings. Theek hai. Then next he talked about that how greed, desire, in fact there are certain flames of desire, hatred, jealousy, lust. So he said that this greed, desire, hatred, they have been the major reason behind everyone's suffering. And you can link it with the incidences of communal violence, you can link it with the incidences of corruption, so that greed, desire, hatred can be discussed. Then how he talked about man is an architect of his own destiny, so that can also be linked. Abhi current context mein hai na, proliferation of godmen. ठीक है, then more emphasis on these priestly or organized religion for that matter. So there he talked, man is an architect of his own destiny. You have to believe in your karma. You have to make efforts. You cannot wait that things, good things will happen to you. So that kind of God, proliferation of godmen basically happens when you don't have the belief in your own capabilities. So he is trying to make an effort here that man is an architect of his own destiny. So that can also be linked. Then how he talked about those eightfold path, to be very precise, that how these eightfold path once followed will help you achieve nirvana, that is extinguishment of the flames of desire. So here the eightfold path, it talks about right understanding, intention, that is wisdom, then right speech, action, livelihood, ethical conduct, right effort, mindfulness and concentration, that is meditation. So this eightfold path can be divided into these three broad headings. Or agar aap chaho to inke jo original terms hain aap wo use kar sakte ho, jaise samyak drishti ho gaya, ya samyak sankalp ho gaya, ya samyak प्रयत्न हो गया, सम्यक स्मृति हो गया, सम्यक समाधि हो गया, या सम्यक कामंत हो गया, सम्यक वाच हो गया. अब राइट स्पीच, सम्यक वाच. आज हम लोग कितने अच्छे से हेट स्पीच बोल देते हैं ना, इन द नेम ऑफ ट्रोलिंग यू से एनी एंड एवरीथिंग, सो दैट इज रॉन्ग. सो एटफोल्ड पाथ में क्लियरली सेड कि राइट स्पीच, ऐसी बानी बोलिए मन का आपा खोए, औरन को शीतल करे आपहु शीतल होए. तो यू शुड से things which are pleasing to your ears. So right kind of speech, samyak vach, is important. Is that very clear? Similarly, it says samyak ajivana, that is right livelihood. You should not do anything to earn money which would be hurting others. So act of corruption, jo ye aaj misappropriation of funds ho raha hai, ya corruption ho raha hai, ya inequality jo badh rahi hai, it can be linked there. Is that very clear? Is it making sense? Then action, samyak kamant, your action should be in the right spirit, your intention should be good, that is samyak sankalp. So your right intention, the intention should be to reduce the suffering and pain of others. So it totally depends upon you that how you are intending to write the answer. How his teachings focused on equality, that is discrimination was existing with respect to caste, creed, and he talked about establishing equality in the society. So that can be talked about. Then you can write any number of teachings you want. You can talk about the temporariness. This is very important. In fact, this is what is meant by detachment. You should be detached. In fact, nishkam karm mein bhi yahi baat kari gayi hai, detached from the outcome of your actions. You should believe that the world, and this is the fact, Buddha said that the world is very temporary. There is momentariness which is existing. So world in the current moment would be very different from the previous and the next moment. So you should have the attitude of detachment, non-attachment, selflessness. Automatically there would be peaceful conflict resolution. So whether it is any kind of social conflict or administrative issue or international relations, this would be addressed. Problem kya hai? We become attached. We have the desire. So that desire, that attachment, it results into various kind of negative feelings or emotions. They say hatred, jealousy, greed. So if you have that feeling, if you have the understanding that the world is temporary, it is momentary, anything can happen in the very next moment, and this is very relevant. Stop getting attached to this material world. Stop getting attached to the material prosperity. It is very temporary. Ab dekh lo, COVID ne hame yahi to sikhaya. You have appropriated funds. What if something happened and you lost your life because of COVID? Sab yahi reh gaya na. So the world is very momentary. You should not be attached. And that is, this is very relevant in the current context when there are increasing incidences of suicide by youth. Why youth is committing suicide? Because they have the attachment with, they have the desire for certain things, either for relationships or the desire to achieve success. And they are so attached either to the individual or to the belief or to the outcome of the action that then it results into depression, anxiety, disorders, and which results into suicide. So this is still very relevant. Then concept of karma, the intention has to be right. आज हम कुछ भी करते हैं, our intent is not right. So the point here is, he has also talked about karma, and he said if a person has right mindset, his actions will not only be beneficial for him as but also for the environment and the world. He talked about that how your effect of karma continues in your next birth also. So here karma by he meant was right kind of intention. Then he talked about his teachings of karuna, compassion is very important. You have to be compassionate towards other. If someone is in distress situation, you should rush towards helping them. That is what is compassion. Or tabhi to peaceful coexistence, social harmony would be established in the society. We have become so individualistic today. We have become so self-interest or self-centric that we don't care what is happening in the world. Wo kehte hai na, jab tak aapke ghar ka sheesha nahi tootta hai, aapko farak nahi padta hai. Is that clear? So you have to make efforts in order to help others who are in the situation of distress. Then loving kindness. Ye baat main keh rahi thi ki yahan pe hum padha denge. Loving kindness is kind of a meditation practice which helps in developing positive attitude. For example, friendliness, compassion, appreciative joy, and equanimity. This equanimity is very important. Why? Because according to this philosophy, it says that you will treat no one as your friend, no one as your enemy, no one would be considered higher, no one would be considered lower. There would not be any kind of discrimination, everyone would be treated equally. And as a result, it will help in establishing inclusive society. Yahi to dikkat hai. We judge others, we try to ostracize them, we try to think ourselves as superior to them. So there is a problem of cultural chauvinism. There is a problem of establishing your supremacy over others. So that can be addressed through this practicing loving kindness. Treat everyone equally. There is no distinction or discrimination. Then bhavna. Bhavna, it is said, training of your mind, because Buddha ultimately believed that everything emanates from man's mind. So there has to be a pure, trained, well-developed mind. It is your greatest treasure. Is that clear? Now, obviously, this is not the ultimate teaching. You can write any number of teachings that you want to write, but make sure you are linking it with the current context. So whether you are mentioning the corruption, or you are mentioning the hate speeches, or you are mentioning communal conflicts, or you are mentioning inclusive society or ostracization of others on the basis of race or prejudice, yahi to hai, that there exist prejudices towards racial community, there exist prejudices towards ethnic community, ye jo son of soil हो रहा है या मास एक्सोडस हो रहा है, दैट इज फीलिंग ऑफ हेट्रेड, सो दैट नीड्स टू बी एड्रेस्ड. इनफैक्ट वो हेट्रेड वाले क्वेश्चन में भी आप चाहो तो ये एग्जांपल्स दे सकते हो, सन ऑफ सॉइल थ्योरी, मास एक्सोडस, बिकॉज इट इज सेड दैट व्हेन यू हैव दैट फीलिंग ऑफ हेट्रेड, इट इज मोर बिकॉज ऑफ हु द अदर पर्सन इज और हु इज द अदर ग्रुप इज रादर देन वॉट दे डू. सो व्हेन यू हैव दैट फीलिंग ऑफ हेट्रेड, इट इज अगेंस्ट ऑल द माइग्रेंट्स. आर यू गेटिंग द पॉइंट? इट इज नॉट टारगेटेड टुवर्ड्स वन इंडिविजुअल बिकॉज ही हैज डन समथिंग. It is because who they are migrants, and that is why natives have the feeling of hatred towards them. So this is not, so in the previous question, and when there is son of soil policy, definitely it dampens nation spirit. So when there is mass exodus, mob lynching vagra mein hota kya hai? You are not venting out your hatred or anger towards that individual because for what he has done, it is because he belongs to a certain community. Is that very clear? Is it making sense? ठीक है. So again, so ये questions आपस में, तभी मैंने ये last three questions एक साथ लिए, because emotional intelligence, hatred and teachings of Buddha में hatred वाला concept, all of them can be understood in a certain relative capacity. Now the conclusion, Buddhist teachings inculcate compassion, calmness, joy, and it is also important for maintaining balance between nature and man. Hence, it is very important because these teachings of Buddha are very relevant today, because it will play a significant role in transforming society into more accommodative, tolerant, better and humane form, and which is very relevant because currently the world is ravaged or is suffering from the problem of violence, destruction, mindless killing or environmental destructions, etc. Is that very clear? So it totally depends how you intend to conclude the answer. So with this, all the six questions comes to an end. I hope whatever we have discussed so far, everything is clear. Please remember the four things which I have told you in the beginning of this session. So from on this note, my area comes to an end. I will be teaching. Okay, there is a confusion often. Yahi faculty hai jo class mein padhayenge, to haan yaar, hum hi hai jo class mein padhayenge. So there are four areas which I deal with: ethics and human interface, attitude, emotional intelligence, and role of socialization. So if you look at your syllabus, clearly these areas have been given. Theek hai? So I hope this session was of some use for you. Obviously, this would be provided. Again, I have told in the previous session also, there is a Telegram channel where I will be uploading these handwritten, all my handwritten content. So underscore Smriti, at the rate of Smriti underscore Shah. So you can join this. So yahan pe koi interaction ke liye nahi hai. This is only for my handwritten material. So I will make available as far as social issues, ethics, essay, whatsoever is there. Is that clear for everyone? Theek hai? So wish you all the very best. So now Aditya sir would be taking the remaining session. Chalo. All the best, people.